center, but hey, look at all these wonderful people, and I actually don't even know some of you, which is amazing. Anyway, welcome to great songs by guys who can't sing. I am Laurie, and this is my fabulous band, whom I will introduce in just a moment. But first, we're just going to get right to it. Would you not say? So, like, a student of mine who's down at Hampshire said that my poster had made the rounds there, and somebody posted on their social with a big thing across it going, rude! Well, okay, maybe, yes. So this title for this show was actually suggested by my partner, Josh, and we talk a lot about, like, what makes a good singer? See, for me, it's always been about, like, tone and beauty of sound. And for him, well, he's a Springsteen fan, so we can't count his taste anyway. I started to do a deep dive into some of these composers, because I never listened to them before. I could not get past the voices. And so I'm hoping that, so men who can't sing, I will take full responsibility. That is my determination. And you are welcome to come up to me afterwards and fight me about Tom Waits, and that's fine. I'll win. Okay. Speaking of Tom Waits, here's one. This is one for you, Johnny.
Without love, it ain't nothing. What a house.
storyteller, like as with that particular song. Sometimes his lyrics are a little obtuse, maybe a little bit, but that's kind of cool because it lets you sort of interpret what you will out of his song. So he was a, he dabbled in so very, very many art forms, from music and folk, pop, rock, experimental music. He's also an actor, he's done a bunch of movies. He's done plays, musicals, he's even done operas. He did an adaptation of Woyzeck, for example, by Berg, which is, okay, I wanna see that. So he was inducted in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and Neil Young, who also could be on my list, and actually is, but I cut him for time. So Neil Young said this about Tom Waits during his speech to induct Tom into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He said, "This next man is indescribable, and I'm here to describe him. He's sort of a performer, singer, actor, magician, spirit guide, changeling. I think it's great that the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame has recognized his immense talent. Could have been the Motion Picture Hall of Fame. Could have been the Blues Hall of Fame. Could have been the Performance Artist Hall of Fame. But it was the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame that recognized the great Tom Waits." And in accepting the award, Tom Waits said, Well,
they say I have no hits and that I'm difficult to work with. And they say that like it's a bad thing.
All right, so let's move on. Mr. Waits and clap hands. A one, two. Clap hands. time I introduce these fabulous gentlemen that are with me. First of all, on my left is Bob Ferrier on guitar. Started asking people, okay, who are the good guitarists in the area? And they would give me three names. Bob's name was always on every single list. And people also said, oh, he's a really nice guy. Of course, they lied.
They're just the right people.
And then we got Brian O'Connell over here on bass. I saw Brian play at our barn with another band. I'm like, him, I want him. So I'm very glad that you're on this gig. Thank you, Brian. And then over there is my dear, dear friend, Rick Marshall. Fun fact, Rick and Bobby grew up together. They've known each other since they were 8. And this is only the third time they've ever played together.
And I can attest, he's not a nice guy.
And since they're such fabulous musicians, I'm going to give them a break for this next song. So occasionally Tom Waits will, certainly he likes to write songs about the sort of seamy underbelly of life. So I've got one other song though that of his that I want to do that doesn't qualify for that. When I first heard this song, I about dropped whatever was in my hands because it's just like this lovely little, well, you'll see.
Child is grown old. Dreams.
by John Prine. And John Prine was when he passed, like every singer-songwriter on the planet took it very, very personally, because he was kind of like the singer-songwriter. He was widely regarded as one of the most influential of his entire generation, sometimes been called the Mark Twain of songwriting. He has an interesting life. He actually was in Germany in the army for a while, came back to Chicago, worked as a mailman, and would write his songs on his route. And a lot of his songs are like that last one, about loneliness. And one of his most famous songs is Hello in There, all about people getting old and getting lonely, which he wrote at a surprisingly young age. And Angel from Montgomery's actually was written as a follow-up to Hello in There. He was discovered in Chicago by Kris Kristofferson, and he had a long career. He actually survived cancer twice. There was a biography of him by a guy named Eddie Huffman, and who quotes this percussionist, Hayward Bishop, who was supposed to play with John Prine. He said, you know, there was no evidence of groove anywhere whatsoever, and I was hungry for groove. Prine came off like a folk poet. This guy was really nasally. He didn't have any tone in his voice. And all of his songs were in the same key. I thought, this is gonna be like milking a dead, blasted dog. So actually, Prine said of himself that his entire career could be summed up with three chords and a capo. That's about right, too. No, but he did say, once I saw so it's not just me who thinks John Prine is not the world's best singer. I saw him about to sing the song Clay Pigeons, which somebody else wrote, and he said, and I quote, I don't usually sing other people's songs because I can barely sing my own. So, thank you, John. Unfortunately, John passed during COVID. He was one of the first big names to catch and to die from COVID, but many people still remember him very fondly. I love John Prine for his humor. He writes great songs, but oh my God, some of them are very funny, like this one. I woke up this morning, put on my slippers, walked in the kitchen,
Long ago, Definitely belongs on my list. And
know that song better as like a Karen Carpenter song, perhaps. And it's, you know, she had this idea, I guess, before I did. So I'll give it to her. But Leon Russell was this amazingly, incredibly prolific dude. Here's a short list of people that he has played with. Ready? Or did play with. Jan and Dean, Gary Lewis and the Playboys, George Harrison, Ringo Starr, Doris Day, Elton John, Ray Charles, Eric Clapton, The Byrds, Barbra Streisand, The Beach Boys, The Ventures, Willie Nelson, Badfinger, The Tijuana Brass, Frank Sinatra, The Band, Bob Dylan, J.J. Cale, B.B. King, Dave Mason, Glenn Campbell, Lynn Anderson, Joe Cocker, The Rolling Stones, and The Flying Burrito Brothers. He's probably best known for his song Tightrope, which I'm not going to do. But I'm going to do this one.
Thank you.
coming. Okay, all right, here we go. We're gonna keep it funky.
Here we go. 1, 2, 3. You know Moe's? All right. So he was a white blues singer from Mississippi, he was very, very well known, but he was new to me until very recently. It has been said that he was a social critic before Bob Dylan and a musical satirist before Randy Newman. I'm on my list. His music influenced a lot of people, including Jimi Hendrix and the Rolling Stones, Tom Waits, the Yardbirds, John Mayall, J.J. Cale, and The Who. He was a white guy from Mississippi who made it in the blues world. When his record album Prestige tried to market him as a pop star, and then went over to Columbia tried, and Atlantic tried to market him as a blues artist. And because he sang the blues, Jet Magazine thought he was black and wanted to interview him. They were sort of surprised by that. And so there's a couple things about this that resonate with me. First of all, I lived in Germany for many years and sang in a lot of different bands. And I would walk in to audition for a band, and they knew that I was an American singer, and they would look at me and go, "You're not black." And I'd go, "Damn! When did that happen?"
I said the same thing.
And also I grew up on the Gold Coast of Connecticut in Darien, and not really wanting for very much in my life. I came from privilege, I have to say. But I always loved the blues, and I remember I had a big brother. Be careful about what you say to your siblings, because they remember it for years. I had a big brother who told me, "You can't sing the blues, you're from Darien, Connecticut." So this is me saying to my brother Jeff. So we're going straight into the stops. Can I have a seat, please? You're sitting here yakking right here in my face. You're coming out exactly like you own in my face. You know, silence was golden. You could raise a dime. We'll be right back. listen to a song and go, oh, wasn't that a beautiful song? I say, yeah, that's a great song. He says, yeah, you don't know who wrote it? Oh, shit, Bob. But in my world, I still, I'm sorry, I just, I can't do it. I can't do it. We were watching the old video of We Are the World. Remember that?
Yeah.
And it was like a who's who of people in the music biz at the time. And I swear to God, Bob Dylan sounded like a caricature of himself. We are the world. We are the children. And I'm like, see? It's not just me. Okay, anyway. So the one song of his that I really liked is called Rainy Day Women Number 12 and 35. Otherwise known as Everybody Must Get Stoned. Right. So the cool thing about this song is that, well, I loved it because it was campy and it was silly and all of that. So it turns out what he did in the studio is he actually made all the musicians trade instruments. So that's why it sounds as weird as it does. So like the trumpeter was on drums and the drummer was playing trombone or so, I don't know. That's why it sounds so bizarre. But I need your help on this song. I promise my students kazoos would be involved. I got a whole bag of kazoos. So this song has a horn section. And the horn section goes like this.
Ready with me, one, two, and...
play. Ready? One, a two, a one, two, ready, go! Mama told me not to come. Mama told, that's Randy Newman, as is dun, 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 dun. You can leave your hat on. Yeah, right? Which Tom Jones recorded, did that beautifully a couple of years, 20, a couple of years.
20. Y'all weren't born yet.
Yes. 65 is a new 45.
Okay. Okay, so maybe Newman's home.
Yeah.
fantastic. Thank you so much. I really, really, really appreciate it. First of all, I want to give, we have one more song, and I just want to give an extra special applause to this fabulous band, Rick Marshall, vocals and drums. He's also a sweetheart. And then Brian O'Connell on the fabulous fretless bass. Your nicest guitarist. So, no set list of songs by men who can't, great songs by men who can't sing would be complete without a couple from Leonard Cohen. I mean, my God, in his last album, I almost did one of the songs from his last album, and I could have made up whatever melody I wanted to, because there was none. There was none at all. So anyway, Cohen is a really interesting guy because he actually didn't start writing songs until he was 30. There's hope for me yet. he was a poet and a novelist first, which is definitely reflected, I think, in his lyrics. And he didn't begin a music career until he was in his 30s, and then he was touring and recording well into his 70s. And for, what, 5 years, he was a Buddhist monk? In the meantime, like, wow. There's actually an entire 2-hour documentary on his song, Hallelujah, which is what I'm going to close the show with. And if you're interested in knowing more than you ever want to know about Leonard Cohen, watch the documentary. It's actually very good. I have to say, though, before I go on, so Hallelujah, I almost didn't put it in the show because I can't stand the song. Because it's overdone, right? It gets done a lot.
Oh, yeah.
It's done inappropriately, like gospel choruses, choirs singing it. It's not a religious song. Not even close to it. She's tied her to the, she's tied her to the chair and shit. I mean, come on. I mean, the only version of this song that I really love is Katie Lang, so if you ever want to hear something fabulous, listen to Katie Lang do this song, because she's amazing. So journalist Larry Sloman described the song Hallelujah as one part biblical and one part the woman that Cohen slept with last night. Citing an unidentified critic that said that Cohen was most interested throughout his career in holiness and horniness. So with this particular song, though, he wrote 150 verses to this song. 150, I'm not going to sing them all, I promise. And so that's why, why not? He's like, we got all night. I think in some ways because he never really considered it done. He never considered it really finished. And so that's why when you listen to different versions of it, like Jeff Buckley or Katie Lang or the other versions, sometimes you'll hear different verses, different lyrics. So with that in mind, I sort of decided to make up my own order. So that, because Cohen's lyrics are very impressionistic. And you ask 6 people what this song means and you're gonna get 6 completely different answers. Even the people that have recorded it understand it as something very different. This is what Cohen had to say about songwriting and about this song in particular. He said, I always thought that I sweated over this stuff, meaning songwriting. I had no idea what sweating over this stuff meant until I found myself in a shabby room at the Royalton Hotel trying to finish the Hallelujah and not being able to finish it. And I remember being in my underwear on the carpet, banging my head against the floor and saying, I can't do it anymore. It's too lonely. It's too hard. Sometimes I thought I would go along with the old beat philosophy, first thought, best thought, but that never worked for me. There hardly is a first thought. It's all sweat. And he also went on to say about songwriting, if I knew where songs came from, I'd go there more often. And Producer John Lissauer said, "No, I never asked him about his lyrics. I never said, oh, well, explain this to me. I wanted to be the audience. I wanted to make the lyrics what they were to the listener. I think it's insulting in a way to ask someone to explain his art. It has to explain itself." So this song is sort of a musical workshop test, honestly. The last quote from Leonard Cohen I'll leave you with is, "You look around you and you see a world that is impenetrable, that cannot be made sense of. You either raise your fist or you say, hallelujah. I try to do both." Now I've heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do ya? It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. The baffled king composing, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Your faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty in the moonlight overthrew you. She tied you to a kitchen chair, she broke your throne and she cut your hair, and from your lips she drew a hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. There was a time that you let me know what's really going on below. truth, I didn't come to